I want to welcome you all tonight. My name is John Holler. I'm the president and CEO of the museum. And on behalf of the trustees and our staff, our thousands of members, and many hundreds of volunteers, it's my pleasure to welcome you to, I think, one of the most sparkling evenings in the history of the museum. This is a really sparkling evening. You're a sparkling group. You look terrific. And I'm just so happy to see you all. Tonight is the story of the progress of people, the progress of the valley, and the progress of this institution. Many historians have called the information age the most transformational time in human history. Other transformations have been as great, none have been as rapid. Other places, like Silicon Valley, have been epicenters of enormous change, the European Renaissance, for example, or the great dynasties of China. But none brought change that has been so profound and so universally felt and distributed. We, at the Computer History Museum, have the good fortune to be the only institution of our kind in the world that is attempting to document, interpret, and preserve this change in real time. I like to say, only half-jokingly, that we may be the only history museum in the world that has more future than it does history. And tonight, you're going to see us taking a major step as we make that work happen. This work, like the information age itself, is a work in progress. Almost 60 years ago, Ken Olson first rescued pieces of the historic Whirlwind vacuum tube computer at MIT just as they were about to become scrap. Those pieces of the Whirlwind became the kernel of this museum. And over the years, we have become really good at collecting things. You'll see some amazing artifacts from our 125,000 item collection tonight. But things in computing are only part of the story. Programs, applications, services, platforms, those are another. But next and most importantly are the people and the world-changing businesses that they've built around the world. So tonight, you will see how we're beginning to pivot the Computer History Museum so that it can tell that complete story, the complete story of the history of computing, and use history as a platform for exploring the impact of those forces on humankind and the technological, social, and economic implications for all of us for the future. Entrepreneurship in a creative and business ecosystem goes hand in hand with the technology of the information age. Across the world, people want to understand why that is and how it happens. What's special about the way it works in Silicon Valley? They want to understand the people who've made the difference, the problems and opportunities they saw, the breakthroughs they produced, the teams and enterprises that resulted, the impact on society and the implications for tomorrow. So tonight, we honor a rare and wonderful group of people who have been near the center of that story and that transformation for a very long time. And we launch Exponential, a center for entrepreneurship and innovation with the goal of helping to capture, tell, and preserve that story and make those forward-looking connections. Here's a look at what Exponential is all about.
One idea can create a billion devices. One idea can become a billion-dollar company. One idea can touch a billion people. Iconic companies and Silicon Valley are proof that the exponential power of innovation and entrepreneurship surrounds us. For the last half century, they have revolutionized how people around the globe live, work, and play. But how did it happen? How does Silicon Valley work? How does one idea translate into exponential impact?
To answer these questions, the Computer History Museum is expanding its work and launching the Exponential Center to explore the worldwide impact of innovation and entrepreneurship.
The Exponential Center is focused on five key initiatives. Extraordinary exhibitions and comprehensive collections, digitally accessible content and dynamic workshops, museum experts and university collaborators, advanced research, innovative live programming bring compelling stories to life. The Exponential Center convenes leaders to influence action for entrepreneurial communities.
We're exploring the people, the companies, and the communities that are transforming our world through exponential technology innovation, economic value creation, and social impact.
The Exponential Center will capture the legendary past and inform, influence, and inspire the next generation of innovators, entrepreneurs, and leaders who will change the world. The Exponential Center at the Computer History Museum starts now.
To fuel this expansion, we're in the middle of a $30 million campaign. We're about $17 million into it. And $10 million of it will go to the Exponential Center. Our Center Executive Director, Marguerite Hancock, who you just saw, and the museum staff have been working on this initiative for 18 months, alongside an advisory board that represents some of the leading investors and innovators and thinkers in Silicon Valley. Their names are in your program this evening, and Marguerite will also introduce them. We're using our perspective and our treasured role as someone once called us, the Switzerland of Silicon Valley, to place entrepreneurship in a context within the information age that we hope everyone will find easier to understand as we move through this time of incredible transformation. We're extraordinarily fortunate to have Marguerite as our executive director. She joined us after a brilliant career for 2 decades at Stanford's Graduate School of Business, where she gained a worldwide reputation in entrepreneurship in high-tech regions across the globe. She will be our host for the rest of the evening, and it's now my pleasure to introduce you to Marguerite so that she can tell you more about Exponential. Have a wonderful evening.
Well, good evening, and let me add my welcome to John's, to each of you tonight. This is a night of celebration, celebrating the founders and builders of the digital age. We truly have a remarkable set of people here in the room, and we're delighted to have you join us this evening. The Exponential Center is one of the newest startups here in the Valley. Here at the museum, we've been working on this idea to think about what if the museum, the Computer History Museum, acclaimed already in computing history, could expand its mission and add, as John has said, the people and the companies who have enabled this kind of exponential impact. Images are all around us that show logarithmic change and growth, from the spiral galaxies to the Nautilus shell to this kind of fractal, and as you'll see, this inspiration for tonight's screen. This is part of phenomenal growth in nature, and it's been part of this alchemy when we combine innovation and entrepreneurship that results in exponential impact. One idea, as we've said, can lead to 1 billion devices, 1 billion people impacted, $1 billion of value creation. The Valley, of course, has been at the center of this. And it's been a story of risk and reward, success and, yes, failure, but unprecedented change. So if any place we're going to be telling this story, why not us? Why not us? And why not now? We have here in this room tonight people who are at the beginning of the pioneering parts of both technology, venture capital, essential ideas that have created iconic companies, as well as this epicenter of change. The opportunity is fleeting to capture the legacy of the past and connect it to inspire the future. This is a story, of course, not just here in the Valley. It's a story that's happening all around the world. And it's a story that's bigger than just a story of technology. On September 25th, 2015, in New York City, 193 countries, nation leaders, agreed and committed to global goals for the next 15 years. This was building on the United Nations Millennium Goals for eradicating poverty. In those goals for the next 15 years, they assigned 17 challenges, global challenges, to be the first generation that would be able to remove poverty, to be the leading generation that would address inequality, to be hopefully the last generation that would need to deal with climate change. Of those 17 goals, goal number 8 is focused on job creation and economic growth with the focus on entrepreneurship. Why entrepreneurship? Entrepreneurship has been shown to be the essential engine for job creation and economic growth. In fact, 70% of the jobs created globally are through entrepreneurial companies. And in many developing countries, that is up to 90%. Michael Dell, who is the United Nations first global ambassador for entrepreneurship, said, their demographics show that we need 600 million new jobs to be created in the next 15 years. 1 billion new jobs needed in the next 20 years. This is the challenge for entrepreneurship. It's bigger than just what's happening here in the Valley, and it's essential for what's happening around the world. So here at the museum, we have this new startup. It's been an extraordinary privilege to come and join the team here, John, the trustees, and others, to build on the legacy, the extraordinary collections that are here, the staff, the experts, the network of people, and to think, what would be at the essence of collecting, so this would be the go-to institution to document these companies and the people and the communities. Tonight, we're honoring these remarkable people who have demonstrated through their luminary lives what it is to be a founder and builder of the digital age. Gordon Moore, Jay Last, Arthur Rock, Regis McKenna, Larry Sonsini, and John Doerr, and in memoriam, Bill Campbell and Andy Grove. We'll have the opportunity to honor each of them later tonight. But of course, this story is also the story of each of you. Each of you are invited because you've been a part of this story and creating this story as a founder or builder of companies. Here in the room tonight, we have over 400 companies represented, founders of over 120 new companies, and board members of over 86 companies. You are an essential part of this story because, as all of us know, innovation and entrepreneurship happens because when people come together. So we honor and celebrate each of you for the companies that you have built, for the companies that you are building today. From Atari, with new gaming, to SunPower, applying computing to each of these. We have tonight you who have built these companies that have had remarkable impact in people's lives, how they work, live, and play. They're also tonight essential members of the ecosystem, venture capitalists, educators, lawyers, accountants, others who have been part of the community, and we salute each of you tonight. I would like to also say that this has been a journey that I've been on with an extraordinary group of people who have committed their time, their talent, their insights, and their energy to creating this new center. These founding advisors are people who know what it is to take an idea, to build it, to build a new institution, and to have impact. I want to thank each of them tonight. Erwin Fetterman, Floyd Kwame, Chuck Holloway, Dave Martin, Regis McKenna, Gary Morgan Thaler, Ray Rothrock, Steve Smith, Larry Sonsini, and Dan Wormanhoven. Please join me in thanking each of these founding advisors. Being part of the Valley, we know that good ideas also need fuel, and so we also pay special tribute to our founding lead supporters, Marka, Deborah, Leslie, Pitch, and Kathy Johnson, and Ray and Meredith Rothrock, as well as generous support from a wide circle of other people here in the Valley. At this launch, I'm thrilled to say that we can announce that we have raised $2.75 million on our way to a $10 million campaign for our first phase of development. So thank you to each of these supporters. Well, we wouldn't be at a museum if we didn't have a few things to share with you. And so tonight I'd like to share some of the jewels of the collection that illustrate this idea of 1 to 1 billion. We have here tonight the HP Model 2000 oscillator. Our first product, this oscillator was built by Bill Hewlett and Dave Packard in the original garage of Silicon Valley. One product became the core of their company, which evolved into two companies worth now $52 billion. We have the Fairchild notebooks. One set of engineering notebooks, including these by Jay Last and Gordon Moore, two of our honorees, these original notebooks, which were invested by venture capitalist Arthur Rock, spawned the $360 billion semiconductor industry, which catalyzed the founding of Silicon Valley. One first product, the Microsoft Altair Basic, distributed on a paper tape like this one signed by Bill Gates and Paul Allen, created the foundation for Microsoft software, including Microsoft Office, used by 1.2 billion people around the world. The Apple offering memo, One Risky Business Plan, by co-founders Steve Jobs and Woz, who's here tonight, with Mike Markella in 1978, that judged the market for Apple computers to be about 100,000 units a year, fueled by a colorful new logo developed by Regis McKenna in this early proof ad, gave rise to 1 billion Apple devices in use today, and Apple is the most valuable company on NASDAQ with a market cap of over $510 billion. We have the Cisco AGS router, one innovation. Its first major product for Cisco launched in 1986, catalyzed Cisco to be the leading supplier of network infrastructure equipment, which enables the internet with now 3.4 billion internet users a year, 46% of the world's population. Google, one invention in online advertising, Google AdWords revolutionized the business model for online search. Google maintains a fleet of colorful bicycles like this, which embody the spirit and playfulness of creativity and innovation. One of many investments led by venture capitalist John Doerr, Google now powers 3.5 billion searches per day to access the world's information. Tombstones. One high-tech lawyer, Larry Sonsini, led business deals from Teledyne in 1970 to recent Google and others, are represented by this collection of 23 tombstones, and along the way pioneered high technology law firm, which has represented more than 3,000 private companies, helping clients raise $50 billion in the last 5 years alone. Last but not least, Facebook motherboard. One motherboard created for the Open Compute Server Project, founded by Facebook in 2011, now including Intel, Rackspace, Apple, Google, and many forms. This motherboard was part of a new movement for using open source for the hardware space and computer servers, which has saved, enabled Facebook to now have more than 1.6 billion people connected, and also disrupted the $141 billion data server market. So that's for you, 8 special artifacts which show the heart of the museum in capturing and preserving and interpreting treasures and keeping them for generations to come. These are the 5 areas of work we've talked about: collection and exhibition, We're collecting not only artifacts, but also oral histories. The museum has over 800 oral histories, people speaking in their own voice about their journey in starting and founding companies. We're also starting to collect business plans, pitch decks, first products, prototypes, and conversations between venture investor and entrepreneur. In research, we've done some preliminary work with LinkedIn to trace the people coming into and moving around Silicon Valley. Where did they come from? What company did they go to? How did their skills evolve? And what are they now doing? In education, we're developing new curriculum content, content that's being used from our oral histories and using to teach policymakers, executives, young entrepreneurs. In the past year, we've done 12 different education prototypes and served 350 people from 20 countries who have come for in-depth, in-person experiences here at the museum. We've also started to develop digital content and curriculum that can be used by others. We have live programming events that bring to life entrepreneurial stories by people speaking there firsthand, whether it's Ryan Hunt, TechCrunch Year Startup of the Year, or Princess Victoria from Sweden. We are bringing events here and convening the community so people can hear firsthand from founders and builders. We'll have a founder series, changemaker series, and a 360 series. We're also combining with our next gen group to have events that are focused for young entrepreneurs. Just give you a sneak peek flavor of that. In October, we'll be having a Day of the Dead party, honoring and celebrating failure in the Valley and having postmortems for how things have failed. That's a not to miss day. Last thought leadership. As John said, the museum is a place of convening, a neutral place to bring together people who are making decisions, leading whether policymakers or business leaders. And we've recently hosted consuls general from 30 countries for a briefing about Silicon Valley, Undersecretary Selig for a private roundtable on his way to China, his first visit to Silicon Valley, and just a couple weeks ago, Chief Data Scientist DJ Patel here from the White House. When we bring all these things together, what could happen if we took all of those parts and looked at a company in depth? We did a prototype with NetApp, and we collected the first business plan. Do you know that it started with 1-800 server? First product. Did research into the flow of the people. Where do the engineers come from, and how do their careers evolve over time? We interviewed 12 key employees, the first engineer, the first salesman, head of HR, and of course, founder, founders, executives, Dan Wormenhoven, venture capitalists, Don Valentine, and others who have helped scale the company. From that, we built digital shorts for education, 120 little nuggets that you can search on key topics, how to build a team, how to negotiate, what do you do when you need to scale, so forth. And then we've used that to build curriculum units that we've been teaching. We've already taught that to a group of executives from Europe. We've also taught it to Special Forces veterans who are coming to the museum to understand how to pivot in their career and learn about from technology companies. So I'd like to end by not only sharing kind of the vision of what we're trying to do here, but also the spirit. What's behind each of these areas? This is a picture here of one of our honorees, Gordon Moore, also here with Qingyu Hu, who's one of our next-gen board members. A few years ago, they were invited here because they were being recognized by Intel for their extraordinary young work that they were doing. She and her Stanford classmate came and met Gordon on that night. It was a transformational experience for them. Here they are with wafers that they had brought that he signed. Last year, watching you, who is now founder of Skybox Imaging, inspired by Gordon and others who have lit the way, had her company acquired by Google for $400 million. She's now leading at Terabella at Google and on our next gen board. This is at the heart of what we're doing here with the Exponential Center. We're capturing the legacy and lessons of the past from the pioneers who have created the iconic companies and led the way. We're doing that to help inspire, inform, and influence the next generation. You who are here are part of this story. It is your story, and we're inviting you to help us create and build this Exponential Center. It's something new. No other museum has done it, and I'm sure no other museum is going to do it the way that we can do it. This is the time we have the rare opportunity to have living pioneers who are here still with us. And more than ever, as shown in the United Nations, global goals, entrepreneurs and entrepreneurship are needed to help human progress, not only here, but around the world. Please join us tonight in Exponential and enjoy your dinner. Thank you very much. Before we eat, we have something very important to do. And that is to pay tribute to two remarkable men who are at the heart of Silicon Valley, Bill Campbell and Andy Grove. In their honor, we've invited two people to pay tributes to them and also prepared with appreciation from to Intuit and also in Andreessen Horowitz, some tribute videos to them. So I'd like to now begin this portion in memory of both of them with a video to Bill Campbell, followed by a tribute by Donna Dubinsky, and then a video tribute to Andy Grove with a tribute by Jim Breyer.
Bill's a complicated person who's, you know, bigger than life. So it's hard to describe him in a short period of time.
Bill's had a lot of impact on our culture, but perhaps the most profound is he taught us early on in our journey that life is a team sport. And the definition of a great player is someone who makes the team stronger, not just someone who's an outstanding player by themselves.
I think Bill Campbell's been the germplasm of Intuit culture. Bill was the moral fiber that could amplify it and cause it to be replicated and hold us all to the standards of being obsessed on delighting our customers. For that, we thank you, Bill.
He has empowered and grown and developed so many leaders throughout Silicon Valley, throughout Intuit, and frankly, throughout the world, some of the biggest leaders of our times. Bill has been in the background.
He's just so there in whatever he does, and he teaches us all, and he makes us all, you know, be better than we thought we could be.
Bill's got that knack. It gets under your skin. Well, you just want to delight this guy.
He's an original. They've broken the mold. I don't think there'll be another Campbell.
Bill's one of those guys you just count your lucky stars that, wow, this guy's in our life. Bill DNA is now part of every one of us in a freaky way. Thank goodness.
There I was in 1983, 27 years old, the first Harvard Business School graduate to work at Apple, when Bill Campbell joined the company as my boss's boss. I often wondered how my life might have turned out differently had I not met Bill at the beginning of my career. His impact on me was so great. But before I elaborate, let's get the basics out of the way. Bill was born in Homestead, Pennsylvania in 1940. He attended Columbia University and played football there. After he graduated with a master's degree in education, he coached college football for a decade before turning to the business world. His love for football was one of the real consistent themes in his life, and his well-known strengths as a coach germinated in this period. I often teased him that every article about Bill inevitably started with former football coach Bill Campbell, no matter what he accomplished. In the business world, he started at J. Walter Thompson and Kodak before being recruited to Apple. Floyd Kwame just told me downstairs that he's the first person he ever interviewed who he gave an offer to on the spot. Bill founded Apple's software subsidiary Claris and then left to join Go. After Go, Bill served a very successful stint as CEO of Intuit. But Bill is really best known for being the CEO whisperer. I stole that from Recode. The CEO whisperer of Silicon Valley. He mentored executives from Steve Jobs to Eric Schmidt to Jeff Bezos. He coached women and minorities. He helped startups and younger companies, in addition to leaders from Google, Intuit, and Twitter, along with supporting leader venture investors like John Doerr, who I'm so happy to see here tonight. And then in his spare time, he served as lead trustee at Columbia, serving, he used to tell me, 12 years of a three-year term. Along the way, Bill always shunned the limelight. He is not well known outside of Silicon Valley because he fought vigorously to decline publicity for himself, wanting the companies and executives he worked with to be the focus. He also became a quiet philanthropist, giving both his money and his time generously, whether to his hometown of Homestead, or to the kids he coached at Sacred Heart, or to the many other nonprofits he supported. And he mentored me. After Claris was acquired, I took a year off and then returned to Silicon Valley, having decided that I wanted to be a CEO. The first person I went to see was Bill. I asked him, "Am I ready? Will you support me?" I knew that anybody in Silicon Valley would call Bill before hiring me as a CEO. And he said yes, and I'll be forever grateful. Now, I learned an awful lot from Bill, but since I've been asked to talk for only 5 minutes, there's no way to capture those lessons. Instead, I can happily refer you to a piece I wrote about this on Medium, where I share 10 of the lessons I learned from Bill. But since my time is short, let me just share one of those lessons in closing, perhaps one that we can all learn the most from. At least as indicated by the readers, this is what the Medium readers highlighted the most in my article, which was my lesson number 7 of 10, focus on the person you're with. Everybody who knew Bill thought he was their best friend. He had an uncanny ability to focus on just you. He didn't look around to see who else might be around the corner. He didn't look at his watch. He didn't sneak a peek at his email. He responded to every word you said. He heard you. So take this lesson from Bill. Listen more carefully. Make sure every person you interact with feels that they are the most important person in the world to you at that particular moment. You know, I've had success in my career and I've worked hard for it, but I know that without Bill, I would not have had the same opportunities. Without the lessons I learned from him, I would not have been as effective. An amazing number of people in Silicon Valley can tell this same story. So for Bill, rest in peace does not feel sufficient. Instead, I'll say, thanks, Coach. I'll miss you terribly. Thank you.
Andy Grove is the quintessential manager of our time. He is absolutely the best.
I think Andy built Silicon Valley. Kind of, if you pick one person who built Silicon Valley, it was Andy. And some of that had to do with the role that Intel played. Andy kind of exemplifies the best of Silicon Valley, and Andy kind of set the model for what a high-quality Silicon Valley company could be.
I was very surprised when I met Andy and seeing a warm and caring, very inspirational human being come into my office, and by the time he left my office, we were hugging.
I first met Andy after a series of pretty hard times at Facebook when a lot of people in his position wouldn't take the time to see me, and he was always so generous.
I couldn't believe it, and we were finally set up for lunch and we went down. So I was like a little bit of a fanboy and trying to hide it. He was familiar with Dropbox, and he gave me a little bit of a grilling about us and the cloud and the NSA and things like that. So he was very direct, which wasn't surprising, but we had a great conversation.
He wills with every fiber of his being for the success of the organization. He had the same kind of way that Steve Jobs did of getting really high performance out of people.
If I had to pick one word to describe Andy, it would be builder. And I mean that both as a builder of technology, but also as a builder of companies and a builder of cultures.
He's confident and vulnerable at the same time. And I think that's probably why he's been an amazing leader in so many different arenas. He's a very forthright and lovely man.
Moments for reflection are unfortunately too rare. I look around the people here tonight. I see so many friends, some neighbors, people who have come together. And Andy Grove, for me, represents all that is great about leadership, about values, about principles that shine through. And I'll just start with a short story. My parents also left Budapest in 1956. My mom actually went to the same university as Andy, and as I was growing up, my parents would send me clippings, pull out the newspaper articles, talk about Intel. My mom worked at DEC and Honeywell, unfortunately. And I idolized Andy for years. And in 1994, I was fortunate. I was a venture capitalist here. Hosted by Intel on an internet conference. Andy was co-hosting. And at a break during the conference, I introduced myself to Andy and simply said, my parents left Budapest in 56, came to the United States in 57. And he spent half an hour with me at that event, simply asking about my personal history, why venture capital, which was a common theme. He would always say, and I know they're the best of the best venture capitalists in the audience, but he would always say, when is it going to happen? When are you going to get an operating job and a real job, Jim? I took some of his advice a little bit more seriously. As all of you know, and many of you work very closely with Andy, he believed that optimists pay attention to good news, but often miss the key indicators and metrics of the bad news. Often when I would meet with Andy, I would let him know how often I would repeat his comments, his thoughts, his warmth in many of the board meetings and the impact on a generation of entrepreneurs here in Silicon Valley, but in Beijing and Europe and all around the world. I went back with my parents to Budapest 2 years ago, and of course everyone was asking, have I ever met Andy Grove? He remains a hero to generations of entrepreneurs, leaders, and Hungarians. And it wasn't the business success, it wasn't the leadership, it wasn't the many attributes that for me defined Andy Grove, because he's as great as they get. It was the warmth, the wry sense of humor, and he always made time, as Mark Zuckerberg and others mentioned, to meet with people, offer advice in only a way that Andy could. So when I first heard that Andy had passed away, I called my mom. My father, last summer, passed away from leukemia. And when I spoke to my mom, I could hear the sadness in her voice about the news on Andy. I'm sure she heard the sadness in my voice. And I reflected a little bit on all that Andy has represented. And one piece of advice that Andy had mentioned to me a number of times, which I think not a week goes by where I don't repeat it or think about it, he said to me, never forget board service, investing, being part of boards and building companies. Those boards, it's a place of truth and trust. And to me, that really is what so beautifully defines Andy Grove. Thank you.
Special thanks to Donna and to Jim for those personal and moving reflections and tributes. To two extraordinary people, Bill and Andy. In their memory, we give thanks for what they have contributed, and in their honor, we will contribute in the lives that we lead. And now it is time for dinner. Please enjoy the conversation and the food. We now begin the presentation of our honorees tonight. The museum is not only a place that celebrates history, but that makes history. Tonight, we have the opportunity to bring together six remarkable individuals. Individually, they have been beacons, pathbreakers, pioneers, essential people who have been at the foundation and bedrock of founding and building the digital age. We'll have the opportunity to honor each of them with a video and walk them on stage. We begin tonight with Gordon Moore.
Dr. Gordon Moore, chairman of the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation, is a seminal figure of the Silicon Age. A fifth-generation Californian, he spent his youth in Pescadero and Redwood City. Following his Caltech chemistry PhD, he made important contributions to silicon technology at Shockley Semiconductor, Fairchild, and Intel. He co-founded Fairchild and Intel, directing R&D and technology strategy at both. He is the longest-serving CEO of Intel, well known for his fundamental insight, Moore's Law. As philanthropist, he and his wife Betty have supported scientific discovery, environmental conservation, patient care improvements, and preservation of the character of the San Francisco Bay Area. Gordon Moore, Silicon Valley's seminal company builder, technology visionary, and philanthropist of the digital age.
Unfortunately, Gordon could not be with us tonight, but he has sent remarks by video, and we'll be sharing that with you now.
Well, we've come a long way, and I'll have to admit we took some paths I never would have anticipated. The big things that came along are awfully hard to predict ahead of time. Well, Silicon Valley has certainly become a center of entrepreneurship. And I think this is driven to a considerable extent by what happened in the early semiconductor industry. Before that, the companies that were here tended to be quite stable. They were companies like Hewlett-Packard and Varian that had developed significant businesses, but stayed together. But when the silicon got here, initially with Bill Shockley, things began to change. Bill was setting up a new company and hired several of us. And after some problems with his management style, a group of us decided we had to leave. And fortunately, one of the group contacted a friend of his father's who'd been a stockbroker and said, there are a bunch of us who like working together, we're all looking for jobs. Is there a company that'd like to hire us all? And that was really, I think, a major step in the beginning of the entrepreneurship. Although none of us were really entrepreneurs then, it kind of tipped the scale in that direction. Fairchild Semiconductor, which was what was founded by this group, after a search where everybody else turned them down, and then became a hotbed of innovation and entrepreneurship. It seemed like every time we had a new product idea, we had several spinoffs. And most of the companies around here, even today, you can probably trace their lineage back to what happened at Fairchild. It was really the place that got the engineer entrepreneur really moving. Entrepreneurship is something that is being pursued much more broadly than it was in my day. I think the young people today can see opportunities coming that need to be exploited and can be exploited. On the other hand, I knew relatively few entrepreneurs that were major successes with their first companies. So I think there's a lot of background that they can still acquire that will help them in doing the right things to make a growing enterprise over an extended period of time. Clearly, the things that are being done are opening vast new markets and incorporating a heck of a lot of new ideas. I wish I could guess where they're going to go, but I think there's a lot of opportunity still remaining. Okay, it's been a pleasure to participate in this event. I want to thank you all for your interest and attention.
Gordon Moore. And now, it's our pleasure and privilege to honor Dr. Jay Last.
Dr. Jay Last is a pioneer of the silicon integrated circuit, the foundation for the digital world. An MIT physics PhD, he joined the Shockley Semiconductor Laboratory in 1956. In 1957, Last co-founded Fairchild Semiconductor, building the first step and repeat camera with Robert Noyce and leading the team that produced the first planar integrated circuit. In 1961, he co-founded the semiconductor division of Teledyne and served as Teledyne's VP for technology through the late 1970s. He founded the Archaeological Conservancy and has become one of the world's foremost collectors of African art. Dr. Jay Last, pioneer of the integrated circuit at the foundation of the digital age, serial entrepreneur, and renaissance leader in technology and art.
Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to accept this honor for myself, certainly, but even more so for the memory of my dear friends and co-workers in the early days at Fairchild. I look back on those early Fairchild days with a great deal of feeling and interest. We were all very young. None of us had any management experience. We had a general idea, a laboratory idea of what we wanted to do to build a transistor. We knew we certainly wanted to build a silicon transistor by diffusion. We knew we wanted to do that way. But there were enormous problems that were developed to turn a device from a laboratory idea into a device that was reliable and saleable and reproducible. We worked together. There were eight of us in the group, as well known by now. Each of us had a different skill, it turned out. Shockley had done a marvelous job of, I would hire him any time as a recruiting agent. But we all, as I said, we each had our own specialty, and we worked together and met regularly to discuss our progress, but we depended completely on each other. It was a remarkable time. We We worked, as I said, together, and in a period of only about 9 months, solved all the problems necessarily. The understanding was a laboratory understanding, and we had to make an invention every day, it seemed, to try to solve these problems. We ended up with a device that it was the first silicon device. It was an enormous success. We did it in a period of just about 9 months, and it was the start of a vast series of other devices. As I say, I accepted this honor tonight in memory of this marvelous group of people that I had the opportunity to work with. Turning to this building here, I followed the development of the Computer History Museum since I first visited it in Boston in the 1990s. I'm very pleased to see how far it's come by now, and the vital role it's playing in documenting the growth of the computer industry. As far as this building goes, I remember visiting this in the 1980s and 70s probably also, when it was occupied by Silicon Graphics, and who had part of, I think, the fact that they were not a successful company was due to overexpanding and building this marvelous structure. but it's very pleasing to me to see the marvelous use that the Computer History Museum has made of this building. And this was what it was destined for. Being here, seeing the remarks in the TV, reminds me of how much time has passed and the monumental changes that have taken place. It comes as a shock to me, and I just can hardly believe it, that this year is the 60th anniversary of us being hired by Shockley and coming here to what is now Silicon Valley. It's just monumental changes have taken place. Certainly, we're looking now at devices that we couldn't even begin to conceive of in these early days. People say, "What were you thinking of in these early days? What vision of the future did you have?" And these devices were so hard to make. We could never conceive of them being a widespread device. We could see that there would be a special use for them in specialized military programs, and that was really the driving force for the start of the transistor business, silicon transistor business. We realized that with silicon, we could satisfy the needs for airborne computers and things like this. As I said, the first devices were strictly military, and we could see that would be a very limited market. We couldn't conceive of it being a widespread commercial device. But as the 60s passed, the devices became easier to produce and less expensive. That was the start of the use in these devices for consumer markets. And that this is what changed the world. It started this enormous explosion of devices. So we're looking here at 60 years of development work. No device has ever had so much effort spent on it. Extremely complex, sophisticated devices today weren't given to us by the tooth fairy, certainly. When you start looking back, I was talking to some people earlier today. We were trying to figure out how much money was spent on developing the present day integrated circuit industry. And you're looking here, you can make a rough idea from the fact that each company spends 10 to 20% of their total net sales on developing new products. You look at 10% of this for a 60-year period, you get an enormous sum. It's just it's in the hundreds of billions of dollars have been spent on this one product. Nothing else even comes close to it. So I was seeing what's happened in the last 60 years. I wonder what's going to happen in the next 60 years, or the next 10 years, or the next year, or tomorrow in this industry. It's hard to tell what's going to happen. We just can't begin to be able to predict what is going to happen. It's certainly, though, it's going to be interesting. It's going to go in directions we don't know, and I think it will continue to change the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jay. Would you like to sit here? Thank you, Dr. Last. And now join me for watching this video about our next honoree, Arthur Rock.
Arthur Rock, founder of Arthur Rock & Company, is one of America's first venture capitalists, a pioneer for venture investing in high technology. As an investment banker in New York at Hayden Stone, he prompted the founding of Fairchild Semiconductor in 1957. In 1961, Rock came to San Francisco, establishing his first venture capital partnership, Davis & Rock. In 1968, he created Arthur Rock & Company. Rock's notable investments include Teledyne, Scientific Data Systems, Apple, and Intel. A leader in Silicon Valley, Rock led Intel's board from 1968 to 1999. Arthur Rock, venture capital pioneer, driving force for iconic companies of the digital age, and foundation builder for Silicon Valley as a center of innovation and entrepreneurship.
Those of you who know me know that I'm not known for being verbose, and I'm not going to be verbose tonight. But I do want to say something about luck. Everybody has luck. But it's very important to have luck early. Now, it was just a matter of luck that in 1957, Eugene Kleiner's letter to his father's broker found its way to me. It was luck for me and luck for the so-called treacherous eight, including my fellow honorees, Jay and Gordon, that Fairchild Semiconductor came into being. Otherwise, they may all have scattered, and there could very well be no silicon in Silicon Valley. I have not made any investments over the last 10 years, and devoting all my time and whatever energy I have left to philanthropy in the education field, primarily in K through 12. If you don't have a high school degree, your odds of getting a decent paying job are practically nil. When you consider that over half the inner city kids do not graduate from high school, and over half of those kids end up in prison, you've got to wonder if we're headed in the wrong direction. So that's what I'm doing now. Thank you very much.
Regis McKenna, founder of Regis McKenna Incorporated, is Silicon Valley's most influential figure in the marketing of high technologies and their firms. He began his career in the 1960s, marketing cutting-edge silicon microchips at Fairchild spin-off General Microelectronics. From 1970, at his own firm, McKenna created new strategies and set new standards for communicating about breakthrough technologies. The microprocessor with Intel, the personal computer with Apple Computer, recombinant DNA genetically engineered medicine with Genentech, and others. A thought leader on marketing, he is author of numerous articles and publications. Regis McKenna, trailblazer in high technology marketing, thought leader for connecting transformative technologies with people, and evangelist for the spirit of Silicon Valley.
Welcome with me to the stage, Regis McKenna. Congratulations, Regis.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Wow. What do I have to follow on here? Giants, it's really an honor and a privilege to be just included on the stage with these people. It's really wonderful, and the other honorees. I'd like to basically thank all the people who have put this together this evening. It's, as you know, the advisory committee. I was on the advisory committee, and for the last 18 months have been planning this, and I think everybody was nervous about how it was going to get launched and how well, but boy, tonight was really an outstanding turnout, and I think we have to thank Marguerite and her staff for really pulling this together. Everybody knows I save everything. I collect a lot of things. And Leslie Berlin's here from Stanford, and she has a lot of my boxes, and so does the Computer Museum have a lot of my archives. But I remember over the years, going back to the early 70s, I've sort of tore out articles on the demise of Silicon Valley. And about every 10 years, there's a host of articles about, and by the way, they all talk about the traffic, the cost of living, the inability for people to move here and live here. I mean, they're all the same, but yet somehow it continues to grow. And in the late 90s, it was we had another sort of surge of these kinds of articles talking about the cost out here of living and so forth and the traffic. And yet, this is a wonderful statistic that from 2000 to today, the number of companies over $5 billion have doubled from 8 to 18. And we have doubled also the companies between 1 and $5 billion to well over 30. So the number of companies that have been growing in this atmosphere during probably the worst recession in the world makes this a really, really unique place. And I think it is due to the exponential growth of the technologies that have occurred over the past 50 years. And certainly my firm benefited from that. I mean, by and large, I sort of got on the train behind Moore's Law and sat, and all the companies that were spinning off became clients. And they were developing technologies, and they were implementing this in new ways and new forms and new shapes. And it was really, for me, it was the most fun job in the world, because I could work on a whole variety of companies and almost in a day never have a different problem to solve. It was always different. It was always challenged. It was always new. And when I talked to some of my employees back then, there's one fellow up in Portland, Jack Ramsey, who used to work on Intel with me. And every time I see him, he just absolutely thanks me, because he said, I had an opportunity to sit down and work with Bob Noyce. And he said that was the greatest experience of my life. And these were the kind, you know, we worked with the original entrepreneurs in these companies. And I don't think a lot of the people have that access today. They don't have access to really what was the decision-making process. And, you know, the companies were very open in those days. You sat in on a lot of the top management meetings. That doesn't happen today. People are in cubicles. They don't learn about the technology and the pain and the struggle that people go through. And the nights of phone calls and of going out at night or early morning to try to solve a problem over breakfast. And I think that the whole goal here of Exponential is to somehow to encapsulate all this and to put it into the stories that, using today's media that is much more dynamic, much more interactive, and much more intuitive from the user standpoint, will really help people around the world better understand what it is to be an entrepreneur and how all the struggles and the ups and the downs, but the continuing process of developing it based upon knowing and being aware of the current technologies as they progress. Again, thank you to everybody for coming this evening and for this award.
Larry Sonsini, chairman of Wilson Sonsini Goodrich and Rosati, is the most prominent lawyer in Silicon Valley, a pioneer of partnerships for the legal profession with technology entrepreneurs. Since 1966, he has led WSGR's rise to preeminence as a source of business advice and corporate law services. Sonsini has been the legal advisor for public offerings of Silicon Valley's legendary companies for five decades, including Cypress Semiconductor, Apple, Netscape, Pixar, Google, and Tesla. He is a leading expert on corporate governance, advising organizations, the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission, and serving on the board of the New York Stock Exchange. Larry Sonsini, vanguard of the legal profession for technology, exceptional partner with entrepreneurs for generations of landmark companies, and builder of Silicon Valley.
Larry Sonsini, what a delight to honor you.
Well, thank you very much. I'm wonderfully and terribly humbled to be here among this group. When I look out at the audience, I see so many of you that can be and should be up here, and I'm very humbled by it. I'm a product of what's happened in the last 50 years when I hung up my shingle in 1966, and I benefited not only from being in the right place, but also working and representing some of the great entrepreneurs. Many of you are in the audience today, and thank you for what you've done for me. But you know, there are many who aren't with us anymore that I worked with closely that had an impact on the Valley and an impact on my career, just to mention. And you know, some of my early clients, very early, Bob Noyce, of course, at Intel, Ken Oshman at Rome, Al Shugart at Seagate, Tommy Davis, who with Arthur did so much for venture capital and eventually Mayfield, Steve Jobs, who I had the privilege to represent for over 30 years, Mike Homer of Netscape, and of course Bill Campbell and Andy, who aren't with us anymore. And this is the cornerstone of Exponential, of what we're trying to put together, and that is we want to capture so much and archive all of this history and experience and judgment and knowledge that really is the foundation for what we've built here. You know, I've been commenting often that Silicon Valley is really no longer a place, it's a concept. And what we need to do is capture the recipe of the Valley, because many countries, many communities are trying to emulate what we have here and are having difficulty because they don't understand the recipe. And Exponential is all about sustaining the recipe. The recipe has several elements. First of all, there's our entrepreneurialism. But you know, without freedom, you can't have creativity. It's stifled. Without freedom, there is no entrepreneurialism by definition. Secondly, diversity. It's critical that we foster diversity. There's no place, and there never has been in the Valley in the 50 years that I've been practicing, room for bias or prejudice. We must embrace our diversity. And of course, meritocracy. You know, failure in this industry is not a stigma, it's just an experience. And on top of that, we've got to recognize the role of the institutions that are part of the recipe. First of all, our universities. They play an extraordinary role in our success. We are able to take technology developed by our graduate students and commercialize it at virtually no cost. A few years ago, I was lecturing at Cambridge, and I was commenting, you don't let technology out of the university. But think of Stanford, think of Berkeley, think of Santa Clara, think of MIT. And then, of course, another key element are the forward-looking corporations. When I started out, there were companies like Watkins Johnson, and Varian, and Fairchild, and Memorex. They were the breeding grounds of entrepreneurs, the breeding grounds for management, really, to help build our companies, and that's happening today with the Googles and the Oracles and so on. And then, of course, another key element is the infrastructure. The accounting firms, the investment banking firms, the law firms that have meant so much to Silicon Valley, not only Wilson Sonsini, but Gordy Davidson at Fenwick and West and Cooley and others, are critical. And of course, then the access to capital. We have really figured out how to access capital. When you look, and I grew up with people like Tommy Davis and Arthur Rock and Pitts Johnson, who's here tonight, and Gene Kleiner. And the template that we used, the term sheets that we used, Arthur, in 1970, are pretty much virtually the same today. And so we have a wonderful recipe here, and on top of it all, we've got the infrastructure, the real estate people who allow us to commercialize our buildings so quickly, and of course, a solid government and a solid regulation that protects intellectual property and protects privacy. Exponential is all about capturing not only the history of that recipe, but to help us maintain it and look forward about it. And so here, I am only a representative of all of you. I'm terribly humbled to be up here, quite frankly, with this group. But I want to thank you for what you're not only doing, but what you've done. And I want to thank Len and this museum and John and Marguerite and all of the advisors for what we're doing at Exponential to keep it going. Thank you very much.
John Doerr, chairman of Kleiner, Perkins, Caufield & Byers, is one of Silicon Valley's legendary and most influential venture investors. Trained in electrical engineering, he came to Silicon Valley in 1974 and joined Intel to help grow its microprocessor business. Since 1980 at KPCB, he has helped entrepreneurs create the next big thing, leading investments in signature firms of the digital world and beyond, including Compaq, Netscape, Google, Amazon, Genentech, Intuit, Twitter, and Uber. Doerr also supports entrepreneurs focused on the environment, public education, and alleviation of global poverty. John Doerr, legendary venture investor, partner extraordinaire to iconic entrepreneurs, and changemaker for creating a better world.
Join me in welcoming John Doerr. John, thank you.
It's certainly an honor to receive this award and to be joined by you this evening alongside of true legends, my mentor, Andy Grove, his boss, Gordon Moore, and their very own VC, Art Rock, my departed best friend and mentor, Bill Campbell, Jay Last, who with Gene Kleiner was a founder of Fairchild. We're all fair children here, remember that. And then Regis McKenna and Larry Sonsini, who I think have helped nearly everyone in this valley. You should know that when Marguerite called me to offer this award, I said, Marguerite, you're making a mistake. Honestly, I can only accept this award under protest, and that's because I for sure don't deserve it. What's really been going on here is we've witnessed, I've been the beneficiary of, three tectonic waves of change in Silicon Valley. And the first was the microchip in the PC. That's when I came to Silicon Valley, just as Intel invented the 8080 microprocessor. In fact, I was there, I saw Woz and Steve Jobs hold up the first Apple computer at the Homebrew Computer Club meeting on Sand Hill Road at Slack. At that time, Intel's headquarters at 3065 Bowers Avenue was surrounded by orchards. The next headquarters was about a half mile down the road, and it was Memorex. And it was a time of desperation for me. I came here with no job, no place to live, and no girlfriend. In fact, my girlfriend, Ann Holland, had dumped me, but was out here in Silicon Valley somewhere, hiding from me. I was really very desperate to find her. And then, in a story that's almost too hard to believe, I landed a summer job, on the suggestion of Art Rock, at Intel. And guess whose office was down the hall from mine? Yep. Ann. So we've been married 38 years last Friday. Yeah. My good fortune in Silicon Valley is entirely due to great mentors and amazing entrepreneurs like Steve Jobs and Mitch Kapor and Bill Gates and Rod Canyon and Steve Case and the Sun co-founders, Vinod and Andy and Scott and Bill Joy. And then there's Scott Cook and Bill Campbell of Intuit, or Donna Dubinsky and Ed Colligan of Handspring and Palm, Gordon Eubanks of Symantec. I mean, the list goes on and on. All those were first wave pioneers. Then, in 1994, everything changed. Jim Clark and Mark Andreessen showed me Mosaic, the first web browser that became Netscape. And we recruited Jim Barksdale, and yes, for sure, everything changed. I started running around declaring that the internet had been underhyped and it's going to be the largest legal creation of wealth. But if you'll recall back then in those heady days, we still dialed up into the internet with 9.6K modems that were incredibly slow. So an entrepreneur by the name of Milo Bedin said, John, we should make a fast internet. We started a company called At Home that built the broadband residential cable modem network. And then along came the great internet pioneers, the Jeff Bezoses and Larry and Sergey, who, by the way, started the 18th search engine company. The first 17, I guess, weren't good enough. And then there was a third wave. It was in 2007. There was another tectonic shift. And I remember a friend, it was Steve Jobs. He never did this, by the way. He pulled out of the pocket of his jeans this iPhone. The first iPhone. And he said, John, this nearly killed our company, nearly killed Apple. It has in it five radios. The most radios we ever put in a device before that was two. And the rest of that journey, the creation of the mobile app economy, is history, with the iPhone 6 now being the most profitable product ever, ever. Now, the good news for you is I'm ready to close these remarks. That's also the good news for me, because what I was going to go into is the list of my failures and fiascos, and that would take the rest of the evening, like Dynabook or Go or Segway or Friendster. In fact, I'm quite sure that Marguerite invited me to the wrong event. I'm going to headline the Day of the Dead. What we know and what we believe about Silicon Valley is the following. Regis McKenna taught me, Silicon Valley is not a place, it's a state of mind. It can be everywhere, it can uplift everyone. And of course, that's the idea of Exponential. We learned it's okay to fail, just don't repeat the same mistakes. We learned the way to create a lot of value is not to cut a tough deal between an entrepreneur and an investor. Instead, as Tom Perkins said, it's to be ruthlessly intellectually honest about where the risk is in a venture, get that up front and out of the way early, and then you've created more value along the way. So Frank Caufield would say, the secret to venture capital, the secret formula is the following. You take a proprietary technology with outstanding entrepreneurs, strategic focus on a large unserved market, a sense of urgency. That's it. The formula is easy. It's reality that's difficult. It's trying to know when you've got those four things. And finally, while all of us in this room are innovation junkies, we worship together at the altar of innovation, we know, as Art Rock told us this evening, ideas are easy. It's execution that's everything, and it takes teams to win. Or as Thomas Edison said, innovation without execution is a hallucination. And the best entrepreneurs and teams, they're made up, we know, of missionaries, not mercenaries. Or as Coach Campbell colorfully said, it's not about the money. Right, Donna? It's about the friggin' money. Almost like that. So today I'm truly honored to back a new generation of amazing entrepreneurs, women and men who are using big data to transform healthcare, reimagining transportation as at Uber and commerce, breakthroughs from batteries to biology. There has never been a better time than now to start a new company, and never a better place to do it than in Silicon Valley with an exponential state of mind. So tonight, with incredible thanks to my dear wife, Anne, my family, my partners, mentors, and many friends here tonight, I'm going to ask you to raise a glass with me in a toast as I accept this award under protest, if you'll join me in agreeing that it's truly in honor of the entrepreneurs. To the entrepreneurs, thank you.
John, thank you. I hope everybody pulls that Android or iOS device out right now and takes this picture, because this is probably one of the most historic moments we'll ever observe here at the History Museum. It's a humbling thing. I'm going to use the same word that Larry used. It's a humbling thing to do this work and to share the stage with these individuals and with Gordon and with the people in this room. And Arthur talked about luck. I happen to think that we at the museum are just about the luckiest people around, because we get to know these amazing pioneers and builders personally. We get to collect their stories, and we get to interpret them for the rest of the world. And I don't think there's any better work around. I can't imagine doing anything more fun. And I personally am very lucky, because I think we have the finest nonprofit board in the country at the Computer History Museum, led by our chairman, Lynn Shustek. And two trustees have been absolutely instrumental in building tonight. So I want to close before we go back to that wonderful area where you had cocktails earlier, which is now all set up for dessert and cordials and a place where we can mingle and talk. I want to call these two trustees up and ask them to do something that John just did, and that's offer a champagne toast to our honorees. The first is Dave Martin, who is the founder of 280 Capital Partners. This whole idea... The whole idea for Exponential started 4 years ago when Dave and I were sitting in a conference room famously named Von Neumann, and we decided that the museum should be doing more in the area of entrepreneurship. And the second one is Steve Smith of Arma Partners, who has been instrumental in building building the museum with us. They were the two founders of the advisory board. They had the wonderful idea to recruit Larry and Regis and Floyd Kwame and all the people that you saw in the program tonight to help get the idea of Exponential off the ground. So Dave and Steve, if you would come up and offer the champagne toast, that would be wonderful.
Thanks, John, for the introduction. We are standing between all of you and dessert and drinks and fun, so let's make this quick. You're on.
So this is going to be multiple toasts to multiple people, institutions, groups. And so sit down, sip the champagne, and at the end we'll have a group hug toast for all of them. I want to start at the top, and the top for us is John Holler, our beloved CEO of the museum and the absolute visionary and supporter of the Entrepreneurship Center Exponential. Without his drive and commitment and continued 3+ year involvement with leading this thing, we wouldn't be here tonight. So, John, thank you, and we toast you.
I'm going to add to that all of the trustees and the executive committee at the museum. They have been incredibly supportive. They come from a lot of different backgrounds and walks of life. They saw the opportunity to create something very special here in this Exponential Center. Len Shustick, our chairman, said, let's go do it, and we're doing it. So thank you to that whole group.
So John and I started with kind of a back of the napkin concept, and we knew we didn't know anything about what we were going to do. So we reached out for a few exploratory committee experts. And the first three people that we asked to get involved externally were Floyd Kwame, Gary Morgenthaler, and God rest his soul, Paul Wise. Again, they started with us with a back of the napkin idea, and they put substance around it, and for John and me in particular, they put belief behind it. And as you know, belief is a very important point. I want to spend 1 minute on Paul. I'd known Paul for 45 years. He unfortunately passed away. I think many in the room know that he was one of the truly early pioneers of tech-focused investing, founding with Bill Draper, Sutter Hill in 1962, and creating a firm that still is vibrant and successful. That then evolved into a broader group, which you were introduced to on the slide, the advisory board that we put together, the founding advisors, and that includes not only Floyd and Gary, but also Irwin Fetterman, Chuck Holloway, Regis, Ray Rothrock, Larry Sonsini, and Dan Wormenhoven, all of whom have contributed not only time, but their thoughtful construct to what the strategy should be for the center that you're hearing about tonight. Thank you to all of you.
And to all of the founders and builders who have created this incredible 60-year run, this is phenomenal. It started here. It has spread around the globe. You in this room and many others that are your colleagues have been the founders and builders of this phenomenon. You have unleashed an unprecedented global explosion of innovation, entrepreneurship, economic growth, and societal benefit. It's truly a remarkable contribution to the world. And we just want to raise this glass and say it's all to you.
So our honorees tonight have already had enough time devoted to them, but I want to state that the honoree and the honors that they have accepted and graciously appreciated is an important thing. But it's what they represent as the institution of creating companies and making companies that create incredible technological and economic and societal benefits that inspire future generations, that is the real give back that they have created for us. Thank you.
We're going to close this with kind of a group toast, but I also want to recognize Marguerite Hancock. She has been the driving force behind the strategy, the execution. She's providing great leadership, and she's a major reason that we have confidence that the Exponential Center is going to be a very important element of this institution for everyone. So, to Marguerite.
We'll both hug you later.
So then we'll meet tomorrow morning early. And
so let's all join together tonight, and maybe it's appropriate to stand with your champagne and toast the formal launch of the Exponential Center. May it grow into the world-impacting institution we believe it will become. We ask you all to leave tonight enthusiastically being ambassadors for and advocates of the Exponential Center. To the center.
Hear, hear.
It's now my pleasure to invite you all to return to the tent and the lobby downstairs for dessert and cordials. Thank you.